and maintainers. They are supporters and maintainers of each other. In short, they are brothers and sisters unto each other, unless otherwise. Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, he said, the women are the shakat. Shakat means sister. It also means half. As humankind has been divided into two halves, men and women, it refers to as half, also as sisters. There are so many social rights that we can speak for weeks together. But due to short of time, I will not be able to touch on the important topics such as polygamy, such as divorce, such as talaq, divorce, because I have opted to spend more time on the other topics, because experience tells me that these topics, inshallah, will be covered in the question answer time. And I hope you will ask questions, and whatever clarification require on this topic, I'll try my level best to give you. Now let's analyze. Now let's analyze the educational rights given to the woman in Islam. The first five verses which were revealed of the Quran Sharif were from Surah Alaq or Surah Iqra, chapter number 96, verse number 1 to 5, which says, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Read, recite, or proclaim in the name of thy Lord. Khalaqal insana min alaq, who has created the human beings from a congealed clot of blood, a leech-like substance. Iqra rabbuka al-akram. Read, thy Lord is most bountiful. Alladhi alama bil kalam, who has taught the use of the pen. Allama al-insana ma lam ya'lam, who has taught the human beings that which he knew not. The first guidance given in the Quran Sharif to the humankind was not to pray, was not to fast, was not to give charity, it was read. Islam pays utmost importance to education. The Prophet ordained the parents, the father and the mother, to see to it that they gave religious education to their daughters. And after a lady married, it was the duty of the husband to provide her with the religious education. If he couldn't do it himself, and if she wanted, he should allow her to go somewhere else to acquire the education. According to Sahih Bukhari, the women were very enthusiastic to acquire knowledge, and they once told the Prophet, you are usually surrounded by men, why don't you give us one particular day so that we too can ask you questions? And the Prophet agreed. Besides he himself going, he sent many other of his sahabas to the women to give them education. Imagine, 1400 years ago, when the women were ill-treated and were only used as chattels, leave aside being educated, Islam asked the women to be educated. We have examples of several Muslim women who are scholars. And the best example I can give you is of Bibi Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, who was the daughter of Hazrat Abu Bakr, the first Khalifa of Islam, may Allah be pleased with him, and the wife of our beloved Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him. She gave guidance even to the Sahabas and to the Khalifas. One of her famous students, Urwa Ibn Azubair, she said that, I have not seen a greater scholar than Aisha in the field of learning of the Quran, in obligatory duties, in lawful and unlawful matters, in literature and poetry, in Arab history. She was not only expert in the religious field, she had profound knowledge of medicine. Whenever the foreign delegates came to the Prophet and discussed, she used to memorize the remedies. She was well versed in the field of maths, and many times the companions came to her to ask problems of mirath, that is inheritance, and how much share should be given to the each individual. She is said to have guided all the four Khalifas. including the companions. And she also gave guidance many a time to Abu Huraira. May Allah be pleased with him. And she herself has narrated 2,210 hadiths. According to Abu Mu'min, according to Abu Musa, who was a famous jurist, he said that whenever we companions had lack of knowledge on a matter, we went to Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, and definitely she had knowledge about it. She said to have taught more than 88 scholars. In short, she was a scholar of the scholars. There are several examples. Even of Safiya, may Allah be pleased with her, was the wife of the Prophet, who was an expert in fiqh, Islamic jurisprudence. And according to Imam An-Nawawi, she was the most intellectual woman of that time. Another example is Umm Salma, may Allah be pleased with her, was the wife of the beloved Prophet. According to Ibn Hajar, she has taught 32 different scholars. There are several examples. Fatima bint Qais, she said to have a discussion on fiqh for a full day with Hazrat Aisha and Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with them both. And still, they could not prove her wrong. According to Imam An-Nawawi, she migrated in the early days and she had profound knowledge. Other examples like Umm Salim, who was the mother of Anas, she is said to be very well versed in the field of Dawah. Other examples are Sayyida Nafisa, who was a granddaughter of Hassan. And she is also said to have taught Imam Shafi, who was the founder of one of the schools of thought. There are several examples. Even Umm al-Darda was the wife of Abu al-Darda. She said to be an expert in science. And even Imam Bukhari has said that she was an expert in a field. You can give several examples. At a time when the women were ill-treated, at a time when women were buried alive when they were born, at that time, Islam had women scholars in the field of medicine, in the field of science, in the field of religion. Because Islam tells that every woman should be educated. Will you call such women's rights in Islam as modernizing or outdated? Let's discuss the legal rights given to a woman in Islam. According to the Islamic law, men and women are equal. The Sharia protects the life and property of a man and woman both. If a man murders a woman, he too will receive the hajj punishment, that's capital punishment of Qisas, according to Surah Baqarah chapter number 2, verse number 178 and 179. He too shall be killed. Likewise, if a woman murders, she too will be killed. According to the Islamic law of Qisas, men and women, irrespective the injury be of the eye, of the nose, of the ear, of the body, both receive equal punishment. And if the guardian of the murderer, even if it be a woman, if she says that forgive the murderer, and she accepts the diyah, that's compensation, her opinion cannot be rejected. They have to accept it. And if there's different opinion between the relatives of the person who's murdered, and some say that the murderer should be killed, and some say that he should be forgiven and diyah should be accepted, people should prevent the relatives from killing that murderer. And irrespective whether the witness or the opinion is given by man or woman, it has same weight. According to Surah Al-Ma'idah, chapter number 5, verse number 38, it says, "Ask to the thief, whether he be man or a woman, cut off his or her hand as a punishment for his crime, an example from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Means if a person robs, irrespective whether he is a man or a woman, his or her hand should be chopped. The punishment is the same. According to Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 2, it says, If any commit fornication, be it a man or a woman, flog them with 100 stripes. The punishment for fornication in Islam, irrespective whether it's a man or a woman, is the same. Flogging with 100 stripes. The punishment for men and women is the same in Islam. In Islam, a woman is allowed to give witness. Imagine, Islam gave right to a woman to be a witness 14 centuries ago. Even now, in as late as 1980, the Jewish rabbi, they were considering that whether the woman should be given a right to act as a witness or not. And Islam gave that right 1400 years ago. According to Surah Nur, chapter 24, verse number 4, it is said that if any of you put a charge against the chastity of a woman, produce 4 witnesses. And if they falter, flog them with 80 stripes. In Islam, for a small crime, you require 2 witnesses. For a big crime, you require 4 witnesses. Accusing a woman falsely is a big crime in Islam. Therefore, you require 4 witnesses. Nowadays, you see in the modern society, you find men abusing women and calling them all sorts of names. They call them prostitutes, etc. And what nothing is done. In an Islamic state, if a man calls her a prostitute in public or anywhere else, and if she takes that man to court, and if that man cannot produce 4 witnesses, or even if he produces 4 witnesses, and if any one of them falter, all of them will receive 80 lashes each. And in future, all the evidence will be rejected. Islam gives utmost importance to the chastity of the woman. When a lady marries, she normally adopts the name of her husband. In Islam, she has the option of either keeping her husband's name, either adopting the name of the husband, or maintaining her maiden name. And maintaining the maiden name is recommended in Islam. And you find in several Muslim societies that women, even after they get married, they maintain their maiden name. Because according to the Islamic law, men and women are equal. Will you call such rights in Islam as modernizing or outdated? Let's analyze the political rights. According to Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 71, which I quoted earlier, which says, "Wal mu'minuna wal mu'minatu, ba'zum awliya ba'z," which says the men and the women, they are supporters of each other. Supporters not only socially, even politically. Politically, the men and women should support each other. Islam gives women the right to vote. If you read Surah Al-Mumtahina, chapter number 60, verse number 12, it says that, "O Prophet, when the believing women come to thee with an oath of fealty," here the Arabic word is bayan. And bayan means much more than our modern present day election. Because Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him, he was not only the messenger of Allah, but he was also the head of the state. And women came to the Prophet and they agreed with him being the head of the state. So Islam gives the woman even the right to vote. Women can even take part in lawmaking. And according to the famous hadith, in which Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he was discussing with the Sahabas and considering putting an upper limit on the mahar, since young men were being discouraged from getting married. A lady from the back seat, she objected and said, when the Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 20, that you can even give a heap of treasure, a heap of gold in mahar, When Quran puts no limit on mahar, who is Umar to put a limit? May Allah be pleased with him. And immediately, Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, Umar is wrong and the lady is right. Imagine, she was a common lady. If it had been a famous lady, the name of the lady would have been mentioned in the hadith. Since the hadith does not mention the name of the lady, we can understand that the lady was a common lady. Means even a common lady can object to the Khalifa, the head of the state. And in technical terms, it will be called that she's objecting to the breach of the constitution. Because Quran is the constitution of the Muslims. That means a woman can even take part in lawmaking. Women have even taken part in the battlefields. There's a full chapter in the Sahih Bukhari mentioning women in the battlefield. Women gave water, they gave first aid to the soldiers, and there is a particular mention of a woman by the name of Nasiba, who were among the few who protected our beloved Prophet during the Battle of Uhud. Because the Quran says, man is the protector of the woman. Under normal circumstances, the woman should not go to the battlefield. It's the duty of the man. Only when required, under necessity, are the women allowed and they should go to the battlefield. Otherwise, no. Otherwise, you will have the same position as you are having in the USA. There, women were allowed to join the battle since 1901, but they were not allowed to take active part. They only played the part of a nurse. Later on, after the feminist movement just had started, in 1973, the feminist movement demanded, why aren't women allowed to take active part in the battlefield? So the American government allowed, after 1976, women were allowed to take active part in the battlefield. And last year, according to a report of the Defense Department of America, which was released on the 23rd of April 1993, it said that 90 people were sexually assaulted in a convention, out of which 83 were women, and 117 officers were charged with indisciplinary action. Imagine, in one convention only, 83 women sexually assaulted. What was the crime of those 117 officers? They made the women run and they snatched at the clothes. They made them parade absolutely nude without even covering the genital parts. They were made to have sex in public. Is this what you call women's rights? If you think that this is what is women's right, then you can keep your rights to yourselves. We don't want our sisters, our daughters, our mothers to be sexually assaulted.